Welcome everyone to this first video about the equilibrium constant lab. We have two goals of this lab: to determine the equilibrium constant for a given target reaction, and to determine the correct stoichiometry of that target reaction. First, let's discuss the target reaction. We will carry out what is called a complex ion formation reaction. The complete reaction is shown at the top. Iron ion, which is covalently bonded to six water molecules, will exchange out one of the water molecules with a thiocyanate ion. Typically, as a shorthand, the water molecules are not included in the formula, so the equation becomes the shorter one shown below. The complex ion is shown here as the product. Let's discuss a bit about complex ions. These are ionic species formed by covalent bonding between a transition metal ion and a species that can donate a lone pair of electrons, which is called a ligand. Transition metal elements have their valence electrons in the d orbitals, and the energy difference between the d orbitals often allows photons in the visible range to be absorbed. This means that complex ions have a variety of colors, as shown here. The complex ion we will work with today is iron thiocyanate, which has a reddish color, as shown below. This allows an easy way to detect this complex ion when it is formed. To calculate the K, or the equilibrium constant, for this reaction, we take product over reactants, or iron thiocyanate over iron times thiocyanate, in which all expressions are equilibrium concentrations. To obtain the equilibrium concentration of the reactants and the products, we typically use the ICE table to organize our reaction information. This is shown here for the target reaction. The I, which stands for initial or before the reaction happens, consists only of reactants and no products. The C, or change, reflects what happens during the reaction, in this case symbolized by the quantity X, that is lost by the reactants and gained by the product. Lastly, the E, or equilibrium, represents the sum of the initial and the change. As a result, we can write the K expression slightly differently as X over initial concentration of iron minus X times initial concentration of thiocyanate minus X. Note that X here is the same as the equilibrium concentration of iron thiocyanate, which is a measurable quantity that we will discuss shortly. To be able to calculate K, therefore, we will need the values of the initial concentration of reactants as well as X, which is the equilibrium concentration of the product. The values we will use to calculate the initial concentration are given in Table 2 in your lab procedure. This table lists five mixtures, each of which contains the two reactants, and once mixed will produce the reddish iron thiocyanate complex ion product. Before we can discuss how to calculate the K value, we first need a detour into how we will measure the concentration of the complex ion, iron thiocyanate. Recall that iron thiocyanate has a reddish color. Because of this property, we can use spectroscopy to measure its concentration. The idea is simple. When an incoming light strikes a solution, some of that light is absorbed by the solution. The transmitted light will have a reduced intensity. The absorbance can be calculated as the log of the intensity of the incoming light, I0, over the intensity of the transmitted light, I. The solution is placed in a fairly transparent container called a cuvette. This absorbance value is automatically shown on the spectrophotometer, for example, 0.5 in this case. The amount of light a solution absorbs depends on its molar concentration. The mathematical relationship is called Beer's law and is shown here. Epsilon is the molar absorptivity, which is a constant value for a given solution at a given wavelength. L represents the length of the path that light travels, which is 1 centimeter in our example. Lastly, C is the molar concentration of the sample. Since we're interested in determining the concentration of the sample, rearranging Beer's law, we get that the concentration of our complex ion is equal to its absorbance divided by epsilon times L. That means, since we know the path length L and we can measure the absorbance of our sample, the only value to determine is epsilon to help us calculate our complex ion concentration. Let me show you how to do this with mixture 1 from one of the five mixtures in table 2. Recall the ICE table setup and how we will calculate the K value. The initial concentration of both iron and thiocyanate in this case can be calculated using the dilution equation M1V1 equals M2V2 using values from table 2 for mixture 1. For the equilibrium concentration of the iron thiocyanate, we will use Beer's law. Let's say our absorbance is 0.182. This will be measured using the spectrophotometer and recorded in your lab report in a table located near the bottom of page 9 as shown here. Our epsilon is 3.78 times 10 to the third per molar per centimeter. We will discuss in the next video how we obtain this value, and our path length in this case is 1 centimeter. If we plug all of these numbers into the equation, we get the equilibrium concentration of iron thiocyanate as 4.81 times 10 to the minus 5 molar. Using the K expression and all the values that we just calculated, we can obtain an equilibrium constant value of 53.1 for mixture 1. In the next video, I will discuss how we obtain epsilon, whose value is given here. I'm going to wrap up this video by discussing how you can use K values as a way to determine the correct stoichiometry for a given reaction. So let's say you have two reactions. You know that the product C is made when you mix A and B together, but you don't know whether the reaction uses 1A and 1B or 1A with 2B. We can actually use the K values to help us pick the right reaction. Since K is a constant, its value should stay the same regardless of how we prepare our reactions. So for this example, we will have two different ways of calculating our K. K1 for stoichiometry 1 and K2 for stoichiometry 2. You see here that the B is squared because of its coefficient of 2. Let's say now I perform my reactions 4 times, each time changing the concentration of A and B that I use, and measuring the concentrations of A, B, and C at equilibrium. The data are given in the first 3 columns in this table. I then calculate the K that I would get from these equilibrium concentrations using the expression for K1 or K2. Notice that in this case, I get the same value of K2 even though the equilibrium concentrations are changing, while the K1 values are changing. This tells me that the correct stoichiometry must be the second one, since its K value is indeed a constant.